evening, everyone. Welcome to UTSA Buena Vista Theater. I want to welcome you back home. If you were here on Friday evening, I mentioned that this campus and this facility especially was a community effort. So I want to welcome you to your home. My name's Roger Enriquez. I'm an associate professor in the College for Health, Community, and Policy, but I'm also the director of the executive director of the Westside Community Partnerships, who, with Academia America and the Department of Regs, is sponsoring this evening's event. We are in for a treat. We truly are. Tonight, we hear from Las Mujeres de la Raza Unida, an opportunity to hear from the women that were there when Raza Unida came into being and unfolded. And so to offer their unique perspective, we have some panelists that were gonna help us with that this evening. I want to, at this point though, also bring to the stage the department chair for the Alejandra Elenas, who's the department chair of the Regs department, who will be the moderator for this evening's event. Alejandra?
Okay. Good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for attending this amazing panel. It is really an honor for me to introduce our panelists today, Rosy Castro and Severita Lara. I'm just gonna talk a little bit about our panel tonight. So our speakers on the panel tonight were leaders and activists with the Texas Raza Unida Party in the 1970s. All were among the hundreds of volunteers that dedicated many hours to organize the party, that performed in multiple capacities to carry out various tasks. They blocked walk, canvassing for supporters, collected petitions, signatures, secure ballot status, service committee chairs, worked the phone banks and staff party offices and candidate campaigns. They provided invaluable service that helped the party run effective campaigns and achieve its goals of the political empowerment of Chicanos and Mexicanos in Texas. All remain active today, furthering the causes that provide continuity to the struggle for social justice for Mexican Americans in Texas and beyond. As Cynthia Orozco reminds us, Mujeres por la Raza representing the merging of Chicano nationalism and feminism. They were part of the rise of the Chicana feminist movement in Texas. Women participated in La Raza Unida Party from its inception and were instrumental in writing the party platform. Yet they hate to contend with the sexism within the party. In spite of women's organizing skills and activism, the leadership of the party was predominantly male. Women, nevertheless, Chicanas in La Raza Unida Party exercised their agency, believing they should have leadership positions. After all, most organizing efforts were done by women. Therefore, in 1973, the women formed Mujeres por la Raza, and they organized for social justice, equal access to education, how to form political campaigns, and against police brutality. So I'm gonna introduce our panel speakers today. So we have Rosy Castro and Severita Lara. Mami Mireles Berry is not gonna be able to join us because she's been battling some health issues. So I think that Rosy Castro really doesn't need an introduction, but deserves one. She's a lifetime community activist and advocate for women's rights. She has been a leader in multiple organizations and social justice causes. She ran for city council in 1975 as candidate for the Committee for Barrio Betterment and served as Bexar County Chair for the Texas Raza Unida Party 1972-74. Rosy Castro is the mother of U.S. Representative Joaquin Castro and former San Antonio Mayor Julian Castro. Rosy continues to be active, supporting multiple social justice causes and to empower women and Mexican Americans. Severita Lara began her career as a community activist and leader in the Chicano student boycott at Crystal City High School in 1969. After completing her undergraduate studies, She enrolled in, she was at St. Mary's University, but graduated from Incarnate Word University. After that, she returned to Crystal City as a school teacher and librarian. In 1986, Severita ran unsuccessfully for county judge of Zavala County in Crystal City. She was subsequently elected to the city council of Crystal City and was appointed mayor. Ms. Lara continues to be active promoting social justice for Chicanos and Mexican Americans to this day. More indeed, she retired as an educator, but recently she has returned to teach science, seventh and eighth grade in La Pryor School District. So we thank you very much for being so brave. So here we have our panelists, Rosy Castro and Severita Lara.
First of all, thank you for being here. We really appreciate having a great audience out here today. And we were asked a couple of things. You probably know that this is the 50th year reunion for Raza Unida, the beginning of Raza Unida. So that's one of the reasons that this is being done. And there'll be some other celebrations later in the month, which I'm sure Mario or someone will tell you about. But the first question that was asked of me was, why did I get involved with Raza Unida? Well, I just want to paint an overall picture of what it was like for Chicanos during that period of time. So some of you, like my friend Bertha over here, will know a lot of this stuff because we went through stuff together. But some may not. So if you think back at the 1960s, you think about, I know everybody thinks of, oh yeah, the 60s, the summer of love. Well, that wasn't all that happened in the 60s. Unfortunately, the 60s were a multiple time. One, we had in 1963, the assassination of John Kennedy. And I was a Catholic school girl, so we were watching that as that was unfolding. In 1968, you have the murder of Martin Luther King and Robert Kennedy. And then at the end of that year in the 60s, now remember, this is kind of the national stage. What has happened to us, I'll talk about in the 70s, but during this whole time, we're really bereft of any civil rights per se. As a matter of fact, it isn't until 1968 that the U.S. Commission on Civil Rights, a national organization, comes into San Antonio at Our Lady of the Lake to look at, for the very first time, the problems that Mexican-Americans were facing. For the very first time, Mexican-Americans throughout the Southwest. So in the late 68, then, you have the farm workers strike and the farm workers marching to Austin, where they are not welcome, where before they even start the march, they encounter the Texas Rangers, who proceed to beat them, and who, for years and years throughout the history of Texas, had played the role of enforcing whatever the growers or those people with money wanted done. And so in this case, the growers did not want to see any better wages for farm workers. And these very courageous people, who are not college educated necessarily, they go and they teach the rest of us what it is like to stand up for yourself. And so that kicks off, and I know that if you look at California, Cesar's doing that in California, but in Texas, South Texas, you're watching that happen too. And so what happens is then we enter into the 1970s. In the 1970s, I would say it was one of the most repressive 10 years that I can remember until now. I would say that the 1970s is equivalent to what much of what we are going through now. And the part of the reason is, one, there was again, at that time, a big fear of immigrants. They were the people rushing over the border, they're gonna take over, and you know, they're dirty, they're lazy, there's all these stereotypes that nobody has addressed. There's all these stereotypes that are allowed to be, that we're told that we are. The other thing that's major, the lack of education. educational opportunities. For me, that was a very big thing. I'm graduating in 1965. I'm sorry, starting in 65, ending 65, I'm graduating. In 65, there was an 80% dropout rate of Chicanos in Texas, a 3 to 4% college going rate. That was the opportunity we had. And so if you were able to go to college, you were very fortunate. So beyond that, you had horrific kinds of things that were going on in terms of nutrition right prior to that. One of the national programs, nationally, NBC, I think it was, had done a study of food shortages throughout the United States. They chose San Antonio as one of those cities to look at. And the reason for that was that in San Antonio, our children, our infants, our Chicanitos in the West Side were dying of hunger. Were dying of hunger. There wasn't enough food. A little bit slightly earlier than that, we had had third world conditions in things like tuberculosis. It was rampant in San Antonio. And of course, you can guess what areas had the most difficulty. And you can see that by the fact that if you still go down today on Sarsamora, where the Diabetes Institute is, you can still see a couple of the little huts that were built for the people with tuberculosis. And so then we have no streets and drainage. We have poor housing. As a matter of fact, the reason we have a housing authority is because Mrs. Roosevelt, Eleanor Roosevelt, came in and there was a priest named Trancasi that took her to see what is now Alasan Apache Court, that took her to see the West Side. And she went and told her husband, you know, we gotta do something. These people, they were living in huts. And if any of you are keeping up with this book that's just come out by the ex-Trinity professor about the flood in 1921, you will, I think it's 21, yeah. Somebody can correct me if it's not. You will see that time and time again, these little huts that people had built and huts that other people built and charged a whole lot of rent for to these people were blown away whenever the flood came. So there was a need for more permanent housing. One of the worst things about the 1970s was the police brutality. In the 1970s, you have the case of Santos Rodriguez in Dallas, a 12-year-old little boy that the police in Dallas pick up with his brother. They put him in the back seat, and they play Russian roulette with Santos, and they kill him. And there was a Hayes Morales case where the sheriff kills a Mexicano. He, his wife, and the sister-in-law take the body away and pretend like it never happened. And that was the first case that was taken to the Justice Department that led to being able to use civil rights litigation against law enforcement. There was just one case after another of police brutality, and we had just witnessed the Texas Rangers brutality against the farm workers. So this is a very dire time, and so, you know, for a person who would be coming out of high school that was all cheery and wanted to, oh, I'm gonna go to college, oh, all this. And then you get there and you find out how badly, I mean, obviously I had lived through poverty. I had seen bias and oppression and prejudice. But when you get to college, you start to realize at a great bigger level what was being taken out of our community, the losses that we were suffering, the throwing away of people that many of us at that time that were young just couldn't tolerate it anymore. And at that time, what people say is, ya basta, it's enough. You know, it stops now. I'm not gonna say we were the first ones to ever try to change things. There had been movements before. We're considered the Chicano movement. Before that, there was the Mexican American movement. Before that, there were other ways that people tried to get their rights. In Texas, to try to make sure people lived up to the Treaty of Guadalupe Hidalgo, and they never did. People lost their lands. People lost their ability to feed their families. People lost a lot of things. And so now these young people are saying, look, I know I ain't stupid. I'm as smart as the next guy. And I know that if we get together, we're able to change things. And for me, it was democracy. It was thinking about the fact that, and learning about the fact that you didn't count if you didn't vote. And that in this country, the only way you got policy made, which we had none, was to be at the table making that policy. And we couldn't do that because we couldn't elect our own people because of redistricting. And remember, the Democrats are in charge then, gerrymandering. And it's not the Republicans they're trying to redistrict again. It's us and African Americans. So for me, I started with Young Democrats, went to Our Lady of the Lake, helped start Young Democrats and Young Republicans because we had to do that. And then went on to do Bexar County chair for Young Democrats and then state VP. But as I did that, the Democratic Party wasn't changing. And so what I had to do was to look at this group of young people, many of them male, who were looking at ideas about what we needed, now ideas of what we needed to do to make this change. And one of those ideas was the Raza Unida Party. So I got involved with that. I became the county chair for Bexar County. And I'll talk a little bit about women's role later, but I think I'm gonna turn it over to Severita.
I enjoyed hearing all the history. Sure. I'm not a history person and I'm not very good with the numbers or years, but before the Raza Unida, well, I was 16 years old and was involved in the Crystal City walkout in 1969, as you heard. And as we were going through the negotiations, in December, when there was school break, people from the Justice Department, from attorneys, everybody was there. And we, the walkout leaders, were there. Some people were in the community were being represented. And when they were going through our 13 demands, the board members that were there, only two were Mexican American. One supported us, the other one didn't. And the other one were Anglo or whites. And I kept hearing them. Yes, we will do this if we have money. Yes, we will get you the books that you want if we have money. We will get your counselor, Mexican-American counselor, if we have money. So we knew that we were gonna win in just words. But when it came down to the real thing, it was not gonna happen. Because we knew right then and there, as I noticed, is that they were in power. And it was up to them to make those decisions. But they didn't like us. They never wanted to hear us. What was gonna be different when we got out of there? They were gonna say yes because they were being pushed to say yes. They had 1,700 students out and the money had stopped coming in. So that's when I knew that we were gonna have to do something to get our people in those positions. And as we left that night, that last night that we were there compromising, I told Jose Angel, he says, well, you all won. I said, no, we didn't. He goes, yes, don't say that. And I said, but it's true. Did you hear that we were not gonna get anything unless they're money? They're in control. We're not ever gonna get anything. And he says, there's ways to do it and we're gonna do something. And we need our own political and our own people to run for those offices. And I just listened, I said, okay, ojalá, hopefully. And so that was the end of the negotiation and we came home, everybody was happy. Not everybody felt the way I did. But After that, Jose Angel says, I'm taking all of you students that have been involved. We're going over to Mission, Texas, and we're going to stay at La Lomita. It was a place that belonged. It was like a monastery or it was a church, but it was unoccupied. And so we all got real excited. We're going in buses down there and all young people. And finally, I get to have a break. I'd been there for 2 weeks solid, meetings and meetings, and I love dancing, and I couldn't go nowhere. So that was kind of like a big break. So we go to La Mission, Texas, and a lot of men and some of the females also went with us, and they were on some type of meetings negotiating. We were having classes about how to talk to people, how to get poll watchers, how to become poll watchers. We talked about many different things that students could do, what our future was in the school, going to college, financial aid. And there was this brown beret, just a quick thing, his name was Tigre, and we were all scared of Tigre. He wasn't very tall, but he was tough. And he kept an eye on us all the time. Where are you going? Come back here. And we had gotten real excited. And some of the, they had a statue of the Virgin Mary. It was white, very pretty. And the kids started saying they wanted to paint the statue. And so somebody went and got paint. So Tigre comes over and he says, what are y'all doing? And I tell him, nothing, I can't climb up there. They're just cleaning it up. He says, no, something's going on here. What's that gallon of paint? And so I said, I don't know. And he says, Severita, you know. So then I said, well, the kids wanna paint the statue brown. And he says, no, we were invited here. We need to ask for permission. You wait. You better not touch that until I go ask that you're not gonna do that. So he left and he says, I leave you in charge. You better not let anybody, not one drop of paint. And everybody was going like, And so finally he comes back and he says, they said it's okay. So I remember that lots of the boys and some of the girls, there was a high statue. I couldn't do that. So, and physically I couldn't do it because when I was 10 years old, I developed a very rare disease that I was an invalid for a whole year that couldn't walk. So there was many things I couldn't do because my muscles had been wasted. And so anyway, but I still kept an eye. I was a supervisor there. And so as this was going on, the men met. And I remember asking Jose Angel that what was going on. He says, oh, we're just having a meeting of what we're gonna do next. And that was it. So we came back from that place and we were all excited because Jose Angel told us that we were gonna get control of the board and that they were gonna run people and kind of explain, not in all detail. I heard about these details as I was reading part of the book, De Ignacio Garcia, the things that happened there that we didn't know. But we did stop in Cotula after much urging Jose Angel to stop because there was a dance there. So I got to dance. But anyway, so that's how we started. So we came back. And we were already working with Tide. You remember the organization? It was an organization that Jose Angel Gutierrez ran. And the office was at his parents' house. That's where we had the office, where the newspaper, we did the newspaper. And nothing with computers. We had to type everything, put those little white pieces of papers to do the corrections, translate. We had a lot of training there. I mean, it was awesome to be able to work in that newspaper. There were Vista volunteers there, and the Brown Berets and other people worked with us, and Jose Angel, they send us to all the students that were working in there to cover city council meetings, school board meetings, and then we had to write a report, and in English, and we had a teacher, Mr. Ignacio Lozano, trying to help us to translate until he got desesperado and brought us a dictionary, the Velasco dictionary. You're gonna start reading and finding the words and doing your translations, and then I'll tell you if you're right or wrong. You're never gonna learn this if you go like this. So that's what we started doing. We would do the headings. I don't know if you ever worked in a newspaper that long ago. We had to rub the letters so that the headings would come out. Then we would come to San Antonio when the newspaper was done, all pasted the pages, and they would print them. I don't remember the name of the printing place. And after we took it, we got together at midnight or whatever time we got back and put it together, the pages. So that was a lesson that all of us there learned. It was like a field experiment that happened with us in Crystal City. And I believe that La Raza Unida would not have had such a good start if the walkout had not been won in Crystal City. I think that was the fire that lit it up so it could go. We felt that we could do something. And when we came back, the parents started getting together, the fathers. They used to have meetings at Sociedad Miguel Hidalgo. And there was a little place there that the Sociedad de Miguel Hidalgo joined and paid membership dues to help people bury their loved ones. And they gave us a place there to meet. So Ciudadanos Unidos was an organization made by Jose Angel and the men from Crystal City. They were the board. If anybody wanted to join our organization, we had to give them a name, so-and-so wants to join, and then they would investigate that person. Would she think like us? Was she gonna support us or him? And then they would vote him in. We, the women, I was a kid at that time, but Luz Gutierrez, Viviana Santiago, Doña Virginia Musquiz, Enriqueta Palacios, a lot of these women that were very active in the movement, we were there, but we helped them with selling tickets for the fundraisers. Well, I didn't make the food. I've never been a cook, but our parents and our aunts, they would cook and get all the food ready for the plate sales. And one time Luz came in and she says, "I'm so tired. We're the only ones cooking and we don't even get to vote." And she said, "Let's get together and let's address the men at Ciudadanos Unidos meeting." And Ciudadanos Unidos was a very important organization. It was a meeting at 12 and we were there always. It was like religion. We went there because we had to know what was happening. Anyway, we got there that Sunday, and it was on Sundays, and Luz Gutierrez addressed the board and said, "Well, we don't think it's fair that we women don't get to vote and we don't belong to the board. So from now on, guys, you find your cooks. We're not cooking anymore." And then we girls stated, "Yes, yes, the women." And then the men talked about it and they said, "Well, we'll let you know. We're gonna put it on the agenda and talk." And Luz Gutierrez says, "No, we want it now or we're all leaving." And so we were all there like, "Oh, this was exciting, you know." Luz Gutierrez was the doña, you know. So it was like, okay, we'll wait. And at that time, La Señora Virginia Musquiz, that also ran under La Partido Raza Unida and won, was a very serious lady, very religious. She gets up and asks to speak. And I told Luz, "Guachate, she's not with us." And she goes, "How do you know? How do you know? We go to the same church." So then she just Ms. Virginia Muski says, wait a minute. How can we demand our women's rights when our men are being discriminated and our children? We cannot be working at opposite sides. We have to come together and support each other. There'll be a time for us later. We need to concentrate. She was very like, and the men were saying, yes, yes, that's right, right? but I think a lot of that, because Ms. Virginia Muskis, you wouldn't expect her to say that because she was very courageous woman. She was older. Yes, she was older. But the religion that we went to, the women was subservient to the men, and the way we dressed and how we addressed and what we did. So I think a lot of it came from the religion. But she did say that, and then a lot of the women there seemed to agree with her and say, yes, that's true. And she says, but then I do think we deserve the right to be on the board and to vote. And then she started talking about the history of the women's vote and how important it was. But she didn't feel that we should be fighting for women's rights. We didn't, until our men had been given or found or had fought for those rights, we had to fight along them. But anyway, they voted. They did vote that day to have the women on the board, and women were selected to be part of the board. So, and many times the women were really not considered in the decisions, because I was asking Rosie if she was there in Mission, and did women go and vote as to, because they voted there to have the project, which was called the Winter Garden Project, to run people for office and create the Partido Raza Unida. And she says, you don't remember because women were not included, right?
Well, on the big, with the five guys, no.
Okay.
Not with the five guys, but with other decisions we were. Mm-hmm. Because we had Mario, which
is not louder.
Can you hear?
Yeah.
Well, usually when you look at Chicano history, they'll talk about Los Cinco, okay? And so I think that people don't really know always who was who or what. So you had the five guys. You had Angel, Mario, Juan Parlan, Nacho Perez, and Willie Velasquez. Willie was never Raza Unida. He was Southwest voter. Juan was really not Raza Unida, I didn't think. He was Mexican-American Unity Council. And Unity Council got funded from Ford, and they would then give money to the other Chicano groups.
Yet he supported us with money, with our trip to Washington, D.C. He was always there.
And he was from Carrizo.
Uh-huh.
But the Raza Unida part of it was really Nacho, Mario, and Angel. And of that, Severita had experience with Angel a lot. I did too, but we had Mario here. And so it's interesting for me because where you always hear that women were not included and all that, I never felt that. Because as county chair, being Virginia Muskis' mm-hmm. counterpart, I ran everything that, you know, all the elections. I had to raise the money to make sure it was spent well and we didn't go to jail. You know, we had to find the people to be election judges.
And that was Ms. Muskis, too.
She and find the candidates. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yes. And, well, I guess, too, it was Jose Angel, you know, always supported us young females, telling us, you can go to college, you can do this. But when we got back, the hard work started, as he said. I was talking to Mario about the number of signatures that were needed to get El Partido Raza Unida on the ballot. Because I remember thinking it was a huge number. We would never do it. And Jose Angel says, yes, you will. We will work day and night, and we're going to get those signatures. And I asked Mario, How many signatures were they? Because to me, it was a huge number. And he said, over 200,000. And I said, no wonder. But we worked, and they trained us, Jose Angel and Luz, what to tell the people. First, at the Ciudadanos Unidos, the men were divided that they needed so many signatures from their families. Then when they got through with their immediate family, then we would go out on the streets. Us, very young high school kids, older people too, like the women. There was a lot of older women that helped us a lot, our parents. And so we went, got all those signatures working. Then they drove us to Cotula, to Carrizo, to Uvalde, and we continued. It was like, it was no fun. It was just getting those signatures. And we finally did. And Mario shared a little bit about that when they went to the Capitol and took boxes and boxes of all the signatures to Bob Bullock. And that I didn't know that. It's just something, some things that when you're young, that you don't look at all those things, right? What's going on? I find out little things now and then, but we worked a lot in to get the partido. And I guess that's why we felt, or I always felt, that the Raza Unida was ours, was mine. It was there to protect my rights, my things that my parents needed. It was inside my corazón. Everybody would say, oh, pues ya la Raza Unida ya no existe. They would tease me or me se burlaban after the Raza Unida folded. And I would say, sí existe. Existe en el corazón de todos nosotros, porque nosotros somos la Raza Unida. Y siempre la seremos. And we still out there work. My mom was very traditional. She didn't like me out there in the front. My dad was pro-women. And in 1969, that was something you didn't see. He would always say, y'all have to go to college. And the Partido Raza Unida is a very good thing. And so it was something that became part of us, so strong. I came to college here. I used to work for the Texas Migrant Council under Luz Gutierrez in early childhood. And they got a program with Our Lady of the Lake. And she sent me to come to school to take 15 hours. And I told her, I don't want to be a teacher. And she says, it's not because you want to be a teacher. It's because you're working at this, and I want you to learn how to do this. I said, okay. So we came, my husband and I came to take these classes. And we lived in the car for over 2 months here. Nobody knew that we didn't have a place to stay. The Good Samaritan Center here helped us stay in the parking lot. And when the nuns and the priests left, we were allowed to go in and take a shower and get dressed. And it took me coming from La Raza Unida and being pro-Chicana and all the racism that we went through, I thought every white person was a bad person. Eran gringos y no nos querían y eran malos. Okay, when I came here and I was living homeless and we were in the car, the professor from Our Lady of the Lake, Patrick Bone, and I'm sharing this because he changed my attitude. He would visit all his students and I kept pushing him, no, not today. My house is really bad. I'm not a good housekeeper. I don't think I ever learned, guys, but I would always use that excuse. Finally, he says, you can't do this anymore, Ms. Lara. You have to. And I said, well, and then I told him, I don't have a home. I'm living in the car, my husband and I was already 6 months pregnant. And so he says, what? Why hadn't you said anything? I said, well, we had $300 and we couldn't even pay the deposit with it. And nobody asked us. Luz Gutierrez didn't ask to just go. You know, you're going to school over there. But nobody thought that we were coming and we didn't have anything. Well, Mr. Bone or Patrick Bone says, no, I will go and look for a place for you. So he took me to Villa Verimendi Homes on Castroville, and he found me a home that day, and we moved in to the Villa Verimendi Homes. The shock coming from a very small little town that first night that we were there, somebody was killed in my backyard as he was running to jump the fence. So I wanted to go home. I didn't want to be here anymore. And so at that time, I was already married. My husband says, no, we can't be failures. I said, but we can't live like this. This is horrible. So anyway, he convinced me. We stayed. I met the nicest family, an immigrant, that I helped her with the English, get her papers. And then I went and told her, I'm not coming back. I have to take care of my baby. My mother told me that if I had a child, she was not going to take care of it, that I was responsible for it. So I'm going back home. And she told me, no, Doña Silvestre was her name. Oh, no, aquí estoy yo. Tú vas a acabar. Yo te lo voy a cuidar. I'm going to take care of your child. So that's, we help each other out. And that's how I ended up staying here, having a home at the Villa Verimendi Homes, made a lot of friends, and eventually enjoyed it. But when I came, the Raza Unida was already running people for office. Then I went back to try and work for a few months because I had my baby in December, with a little bit a week before school was out. And finally, Luz says, apply so you can get to college. You don't have to stay the whole year. And I said, wow, that's awesome. My husband was already at St. Mary's, and I didn't want to leave him alone. But anyway, the Raza Unida, to show you how strong that pool was for us, is that we were working as poll watchers. We were running against the strong Democratic Party. So we had poll watchers, we were trained. We went for every election. Every weekend, Ezequiel, my husband, and I were at the Ciudadanos Unidos meeting. It was religion. We were there in a car that took us almost 4 hours to get there, 4 hours to come back, but we were there. And the Raza Unida, the people that were there, it was awesome to go to the board meetings because we continued reporting on what was happening, the things that were being done for us. There were programs. A lot of people even now put La Raza Unida and Crystal down, but I tell them, no, the offices here, the city, the county, the school were almost totally 99% Anglo, the employees. We had, 95% Mexican-American. At the city, you didn't find one person that spoke Spanish. At the schools, maybe one secretary. We had two Hispanic or Mexican-American teachers. But when the Raza Unida won at the school board, there was a complete change. People say we ran the white people away. We didn't. They left. They didn't want to be there and be governed by the Mexicans, as they said that. So when the Mexican-Americans took over, you could see the difference. But then they started bringing in people from the outside, from Del Rio, from the Valley, from other states, Mexican-Americans that were educated, but not from Crystal City. We're very territorial. You know, you belong to us. We want people from Crystal. So as a result of the board members, Raza Unida having the same thoughts as we did and the same needs that they wanted for their kids. They brought a program for superintendents. It was called the Carnegie Program. And a lot of people from Crystal City became superintendents and later took over the jobs that people were doing from other places. I don't really remember where they were all from. I remember some of their names. Ms. Velma Ibarra, who's here, was one of the outsiders from Del Rio, her and her husband, that came to teach in Crystal City and stayed there. So she's one of us. We were talking about a lot of the people didn't like too many outsiders, different thinking, very liberal. And Velma says, but they were very good with us. But because her husband was the band director and the band went up sky high in numbers, participation. But again, a lot of our Chicanitos didn't participate in band because they had to buy their own instruments. They had to pay for everything, and there was no money for that. So when La Raza Unida took over, they found a way to buy the instruments for the kids. So all our kids resulted as playing and belonging to be members of the band. It was an awesome to see them participate, march. Their cheerleaders, we went from four Anglos and one Mexican-American to almost total twirlers and everything. So it's a beautiful thing to see. Other programs too, the Grow Your Own, we had a teacher aides. They were hiring them to work Mexican-American locally. And at that time, Velma made a grant, a proposal for a thing called Grow Your Own. It still exists today. And we started sending the teachers to be educated. They gave them time off. So they became the teachers. So many of our teachers that are retired sometimes, some still back teaching, were elementary, high school teachers, our own. And very important that we, not only the graduation percentages started going up. I remember my mother said that she found it so comforting. My mom had a fourth grade education and her English was very broken. And she would say, I hated to go to the school to talk about my little brother, which were 20 years apart. And she would say, but now I'm so comfortable, mija. Hablan mi lengua. Saben lo que estoy pasando con este muchacho. But so it was like people were comfortable to go to the schools and talk to them. It was a big changeover. At the city hall, there were all Mexican-Americans there. I remember a lot younger, I would go with my dad to translate. I didn't have to do that anymore. He said, ya se te acabó tu trabajo, mija. And I would say, ¿a cuál, dad? And he would say, ya no tienes que ir a traducirme. Ahora hay mexicanos que me entienden. So it was really a complete change all over the school, in the community. If there was something wrong, they knew that they could go, they would be heard. Eventually, in the state races, it was very exciting hearing in Crystal City, everybody that ran state races, Mario Ramsey Muñiz was an awesome speaker. We met African-Americans, Black Americans that were, I think one of them was Jackson. He was Julian.
We had T.C. Calvert in San Antonio, I know was a state rep candidate, but we ran state rep candidates. We had several women that ran in different times.
Alma Canales, I remember her very.
Maria Elena Martinez, who will be honored at the end of the month.
So we met all these powerful women and people that were educated. come down to Crystal City, and it was a lot of excitement that was going on. But they had some local people. I still remember the name of Juan Hernandez. Do you remember him, Mario? He ran for senator, and I remember his pride. I kept thinking, he's not going to make it. But he was running for it and going in politicking like I'm going to make it. I'm going to be there. And so we used to call him El Senador. He gave himself that nickname because he was running for senator. And when he lost, that people lost, I mean, us younger people, we were devastated. We didn't understand that you adults that were running for office knew you were going to lose, and that the numbers were not gonna be significant, but yet they were, because that's when the Republican Party became more prominent at that time, because the Raza Unida took a large amount of votes from some of the Democrats. Correct me if I'm wrong, I remember that, because the Republican, we had a lot of problems with health issues in our community, in Zavala County and all around, no insurance, nowhere to go. Our kids were dying, babies were dying, infested with worms, premature, many, many illnesses that they had. And Luz Gutierrez started doing a proposal. And again, I remember working in the community, getting signatures, doing questionnaires so we could get money for the clinic. And the ones that came and gave us that money was the Republican Party. That I do remember.
Sometimes it was the Democratic Party. Actually, one of the things when you look at what were the results of Raza Unida, which we were asked to speak about too, you saw what happened in a district where you could actually take over. So you had almost a dream. But in other areas where you could not take over, what we did see happening was that, one, the number of women involved in politics really mushroomed. In Bexar County, we had people like Irma Mireles, who was the state secretary. We had Ana Benavides. We had Juanita Luera, several women. And the sad thing has been that there's very little written about the women of Raza Unida, like Severita, like Ms. Musquiz, but all over Texas, Alma Canales, Maria Mat. All over Texas, there were women and that were now being active. Besides that, then, one of the things that happened was that the Democratic Party, which had not welcomed Latinos, Chicanos, Mexican-Americans, anybody, African-Americans either, in their executive committee, started to put people on their executive committee that were Latino and African-American. The other thing that happened was that I can remember clearly the director of SER. If any of you remember SER,
yes.
It was funded some years back to do work job training. He came up to me one night and he said, oh, well, we're so glad to have y'all, you know, because they thought we were just loud mouths and whatever else, militants we were called, all these things we were called. Says, but I just want you to know that Preston Smith gave us $1 million today for SED. So whether we, you know, people have never attributed those things to Raza Unida because they're not spoken of per se, but in fact, they were in a position, they were put in a position that either they shit or got off the pot. I mean, they had to put money into our communities or they knew they were going to be losing ground. And in fact, they lost ground, not just because of Raza Unida, but because I think in time, they failed to pivot. There was a conservative party, Democratic Party, and a more liberal one. And the conservatives, what happened was that they moved into the Republican Party as they saw that Mexican-Americans were making different kinds of choices when it came to politics. One of the very important things, I think, the same thing probably happened to Severita as to me. My mother became a naturalized citizen in the 60s, And she voted for the first time with Raza Unida. So like Severita said, we had to go door to door to pick up the petitions to make the party. These were not our rules. The state had a set of rules that we had to abide by. And a lot of that work was done out of Bexar County. We had to get state candidates. We had to get those petitions. The petitions were based upon 10% of the amount of votes that that Democratic governor had gotten 2 years before. Okay, so that's why you had 200,000 votes. We were able to do that. We were about the only place, Texas was about the only place in the United States that was able to do that.
But then really, the numbers went up because of the percentage, the numbers that Raza Unida got, more signatures.
More people were registered, more people were voting. There was a reason to vote when you had your own candidates. But one of the things Severita was saying, two things. One, you had to do the work yourself. We had to learn the election code. We had to learn to be working a poll inside, to be election judges. We had to learn all those things. So many things to learn. But because we did, that carried into the future. Now we knew the political process, which we didn't know before. And now we could interact with it in a way that we could not before. The second thing is that's important, I think, for today, is that just like they went off to retreats to look at the ideas and to look at, to learn how to do things, I think our community is going to have to do the very same thing now. If the Republicans in Texas continue to throw this stuff of critical race theory, which they don't even know what it means, if they continue or try to limit people's ability to teach in the public schools, then I think our nonprofit groups are going to have to do something similar to Las Escuelitas to be able to teach our kids the history, and not just about Chicanos, but about all of the other groups that are traditionally left out.
And the language, we're losing it. We're losing in our kids, the Spanish language. It's like, and I can say that with my own grandkids, you know, they understand it, but they can't speak it very well. And I'm not a very happy camper, but that's the way it is. It's a different generation. Now the kids, I'm teaching seventh and eighth graders, and they don't know very much Spanish at all, few words. Sometimes I'll say a word in Spanish and it says, what? What did you say? We don't know what you're saying. So we need to go back to try to get that language back, because once we lose the language, we've lost a lot of our culture already. Look at at least in Crystal City, the Cinco de Mayo, and I've seen it in Uvalde, used to be packed when I was young, or the 16 de Septiembre. Now the parade is just about 10 cars, very few people. I don't know here if it's different. But again, and talking about the Democratic Party, I think our people too were tired, that they would come, get our vote and vote, and I'm gonna do this, then they'd forget. And I think because La Raza Unida was here, y les dimos un sustito, they came back and started being responsive to what our needs were. And again, I'm not against the Democratic Party. Later, when I came back to Crystal City to teach, I ran for county judge under the Democratic Party. Four men and myself as a female, I was given no help from the Democratic Party. I had to finance myself, do everything, because they didn't help me at that time. I lost, yes, but I won by one vote. On the recount, and that's something that I want to say, because I never say I lost the election. I won the election, pero me la robaron. I didn't have money to hire the top lawyer in the state, like my contrincante. So it's very hard to run. And I think that's another thing that we have to organize to help people that are running. When I ran at that time, the advertising, everything, we did fundraisers. And at that time, we didn't pay anybody to walk the streets like now that they pay people to walk the streets to do this. You know, we did it all ourselves. People volunteered to help at that time. Right now, nobody really, a lot of people don't want to run because they feel like it takes a lot of money, and it takes a lot of money to run an election. So when the recount happened, I lost by 2 votes, went to court, but lost the court. But it was a struggle, and it turned my kids off to politics very much so. Not myself. I then later, 10 years after that, ran for city council and became the mayor. There's a lot in the Raza Unida. Also, before I forget, we were able to develop a model bilingual program statewide. Crystal City did that as a result of having Mexican-American teachers, administrators, and a board that supported it. It was an awesome program. We lost some of that now. I don't know how much, but they don't have the bilingual like we used to have. There's still some of it, but not to that extent. We also, our numbers, graduation and going to college have gone up tremendously. And I don't have the numbers for you, but also to quote a professor from Laredo University, says that we, Crystal City, there are more PhDs come out of people from Crystal City. And I'm very, very proud of that. The number of Hispanic graduates with PhDs not too long ago was 2 point something. It's probably gone up now. But our number, our PhDs from Crystal City is higher than any other town in Texas or US of Hispanics. So I'm proud of that and proud to say that I have a sister that teaches the University of Minnesota, and she has a PhD. So we were competing, but I beat her with a master's and she beat me with a PhD. I'm very competitive, but I think I'll stop, you know, there with my education at least for a while. But I do believe I had been coming to the university to get the cultural, the MAS. I think that's an awesome program here at the university. It's a Mexican-American studies. I've been wanting to come and see if I can get some of those classes. And I don't know if there's a certification or not, but.
I can answer that question. So we offer, under the Department of Race, Ethnicity, Gender, Sexuality Studies regs, we offer a BA in Mexican-American Studies. And we just launched this fall a graduate certificate in Mexican-American Studies, and we're finishing a proposal for a master's in Mexican-American Studies. So
that's good, because I would to do that in my old age, to get that and maybe teach that and contract with the schools, because like in Crystal City, we don't have it at the schools. I think you need 15 signatures or something from their parents to bring the class in. So I haven't investigated that. I haven't done too much but in that area, but I believe that it is something great. Is anybody in the audience, students that are doing that, the Mexican-American Studies? All right, more power to you. It's awesome. Yes. Awesome.
I think we do have one of the faculty members, right? Is that, yeah. There's Dr. Sonia Aleman.
Dr. who?
Sonia Aleman.
Aleman. Mm-hmm. Yes, I'm glad because we sometimes don't educate our kids as to that. For example, I was a teacher for 25 years and I hardly ever brought the walkout and talked about it as a science teacher. I didn't do it because I was embarrassed, but I didn't want him to say, ah, mírala, se la está madreando ya sola, verdad, se está dando paquete. I didn't want that. But other teachers there invited me to their classes so that I could do a presentation on it. But I remember that my son went to the University of Wisconsin where Mario was teaching a class, and he was talking about Crystal City. And he was talking about the time that I had gotten suspended during the walkout, and my son was shocked. He didn't know a lot of the information that Mario was talking about Crystal City that I had done and brought about, because I had failed to tell my own son my history. And he called me and he says, and Dr. Compián made me stand up in the class and says, this is her son. Mom, I got a spanking when I got into trouble. How come you were suspended? I said, it was different. But we fell. I fell with my own kids. Now I make it a point to discuss it with my grandkids. I have a graduate from St. Mary's with a master's in hospital administration. When she was in high school, she took me to Uvalde High School and did a presentation, and I spoke. And I was kind of surprised they let me in. Spoke there. You develop a, I don't know, Rosie probably does. I go to meetings in Crystal City, can be the city council, can be the school or any, and they ask me, what are you coming here for? What are you gonna discuss? You didn't sign to speak up. You're not gonna be able to speak up. No, I'm just here to listen. Or yes, I already signed up for something that I wanna discuss, but it's like they get like, oh, what do you want? You become known as being an advocate. I've been an advocate all my life, and I still do. I help parents with a big, abuse, sexual abuse case from a teacher. We took him to court. I was not working for the district at that time. And so I've done a lot, but you know, when you do this and you become an advocate, we put our lives and our kids' lives on the line. I'm not, you know, sharing with you all the sacrifice, all of the threats that we got, my family, for participating, especially when La Raza Unida started to take over. So a lot of things, you all, I hope that you will become advocates in your neighborhoods. For example, I have a home here in San Antonio on 19th and Commerce Street. I have a home there, and they finally told me at the appraisal district that I can't go represent some of my neighbors as to why their values are so high. That in order that I've been there with too many as a volunteer, and that I need to get a license for that. So they already know me. I did that the first years I came. Oh, your value is too high in your house. So I would get ready all the pictures, and I would go present myself to help them out, and they would get a big reduction. So pretty soon they told me I needed to get a license to do it.
Yeah, and I think, but, you know, that's another very important point, that, you know, because we were active so young, we were never afraid to approach government. And one of the things I see today because of my sons is that I see people who are people that are fearful to approach their own representatives. That should not be. Whether that representative is Latino or not Latino, I think, you know, they work for us, and right, they need to make sure they understand that. But the training, the kind of training we got, just lent itself to,
right,
never being shy about, you know, making sure that they understood what the needs were of the community.
And
I don't know if you want to open it up.
Yeah, I was just gonna say that I think this discussion has been amazing, but I think we might do have, and I think I see a hand over there. If you want to ask a question.
Microphone here, so who had their hand up first? Okay.
Rosie, one of the things I remember about the Raza Unida ladies, women, was that you all did all the white papers and the policy analysis and writing up position papers and all of that stuff, but never got credit. So can you speak a little bit to some of that you guys, the women, would come up with the strategies and the ideas, and the men would run with them?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, we do a lot of stuff collectively, and one of the things that we did in Bexar County was that because we were kind of the central part for the state, you know, we did a lot of stuff, males and females collectively, and women were very much part of not just doing the food and all that kind of stuff, but, you know, actually putting together the fundraisers and what we were going to do. Like I said, I never felt that we were left out of the equation. I think if anybody left us out, it was the media, because the media was attracted to, you know, if anybody said a wild statement, which Angel could do very well, you know, the media picked up on that right away. But I think for the women, one of the things Severita mentioned, it's that we did a lot of training. And so I don't know if you recall, Bertha, or if you went to it, the YWCA had a huge conference for women that was a Raza Unida conference for women. And there were constantly kind of trainings for women. And I think that really helped make more women involved in the politics of things. When I was growing up, when I was coming up, we had only 4 Mexican-American males that were elected to office in Bexar County: Joe Bernal, Albert Pena, Henry B., and Pete Torres. And everyone knew their wives as Mr., Mrs. Bernal, Mrs. Torres, Mrs. In Raza Unida, yes, there was a Luz Bazán, but you knew Luz Bazán Gutierrez. You knew she wasn't just Mrs. Gutierrez. She could fly a plane, literally. I mean, so I think there was a strength in Raza Unida, and we took advantage. In Crystal, they confronted Luz and the women there, confronted the men here. We didn't really feel the need to, because, I mean, you had Choco Mesa, yet, you know, you had women that sometimes were referred to as ballbusters, even, because they were just very strong women.
But sometimes you do, like in the political, being on the city council, you have to take a step back. I'm very assertive, and when I know I'm right, I'll go at it and go at it. I want this done, and I would do that at the city council. And I know that los ponía hasta aquí, because once I wanted something and I wanted it for the community, I kept at it. But then I wasn't getting anywhere with some of the men and the other women that was there, because I just couldn't. So then I stepped back and I said, you know what? It's okay for her to get the credit. I don't care for the credit as long as it gets done. So when I started to back up and I selected one of them and showed him, hey, look, this is a good idea. Look at it. And you can present it at the next city council meeting. And so I would step back and they would. It was theirs and I supported them. So I think maybe that's part of the things that we also have to learn, to kind of step back, because sometimes, well, as women in Crystal, we know that we're the movers there. We're the ones that does everything. And when I was chosen to represent the walkout, it was because I was very outspoken all the time. But that came back from my parents. And all three of us, we look back, how did we survive being the leaders when there was so much? We had an Anglo sheriff. They come after us for any little thing. And the Texas Rangers. I know that while Luz Gutierrez and Viviana Santiago were being poll watchers in one of the places where election was taking place, And they were being adamant because we knew, we had studied that. We were good at it in challenging the votes. Well, the ranger comes out and drags Viviana and Luz out of the polling place. So those are the things that we looked at, that was what was happening to us, the women. But also we look at, we, three of us that were the walkout leaders, our parents were middle class. They had their own jobs. They had their own businesses. They didn't need the white establishment for anything, okay? So that was, I think, our strength. And also, my dad was born in Hondo. My mom was born in Dili. But my dad was very Mexicano, taught us the history del Mexicano. Every supper, we would hear the stories, you know, the pride in buying things from Mexico. So I think it has a lot to do with the upbringing, very, very at the bottom level with our parents as we're growing up. Also the income where it comes from. But as always, people find a way. They ended up destroying some of these people's businesses, like my dad with Urban Renewal. They completely put a road through the business, closed it down, gave him a minimal amount, didn't want him to put his business there. My dad hired an attorney from here, from San Antonio, to do the eminent domain and won, and that attorney was Pat Maloney at that time, not very well known then, but he was a young attorney. So they did that with our parents. It was a big struggle when that happened. A lot of suffering with no income from my dad. Was really horrible time to go through. But they always find ways to do it, and we have to rise above it and do more. But we, you students, are gonna have to go back like what we started, because I noticed that the discrimination and things are getting out of control again.
Well, you know, what I think is interesting, though, when you look at, and we got asked, I think Friday might have come up, the idea of today versus then. Obviously, these are different times. I often look at my son's style versus my style. They're different styles because they are inside a political government type of thing. But what's interesting is that in those days, we didn't have the kind of resources that young people today have. You know, Sarita mentioned, you were doing the newspaper, you were typing, you were having to do, you know, all these communications were so different. Now today, you can do a tweet, you can do social media, you can do a fax, you can do anything quickly and generate organized people. And I think that that's happening very rapidly today. You know, there's a lot of difference in, also, there was a lot of difference in how we felt the bias and the prejudice, not just as Chicanos, but as Chicanas. And that bias and prejudice often came not just from sometimes within the movement itself, but from feminist Anglo women who felt that Chicanas should be doing certain things. We didn't feel that way. There's a difference, but there's some similarities happening now in that you're being confronted with things very similar to what we were. There's an openness now to racism. There's white supremacy now. Mm-hmm. There's police brutality without any challenges to those police to reform themselves. And so, and like I said earlier, I think you're gonna be put into a position where all of us are, where we're going to have to help our younger brothers and sisters to learn about their culture and their heritage and other people's cultural and other people's struggles and our struggles as well. I think that's gonna be very important. Otherwise, we lose a generation.
Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for that.
So my name is Henrietta Queta Flores LaGrange, And I'm very proud of wearing my shirt that says Viva Mexico. I had it made. And this is actually my son. My son teaches mariachi music at Brackenridge High School. And he's been there, I'm not gonna tell you how long, because then I'll age myself. And one of the things, like Rosie was saying, and I'm gonna tell you, Rosie, I'm proud of you, Severita, I'm proud of you, and I'm proud of Velma Ibarra, is that when my sons were growing up, they wanted rock and roll, and I said, there's no rock and roll in this house. All we had was KCOR, and I listened to it, and I still, that's my go-to music, is mariachi music, and let me tell you how proud of my son is. He does has done arrangements for the Longhorn Band, and right now he is arranging music, symphony music, for the University of Chicago. And let me tell you, Severita, you don't have to be on the board, because I've done it. I have taken people to help arrange their taxes, either lower the value of the house or make payment arrangements. And I was nominated to be on the board, but I was not selected because the guy that's helping me get in, telling me the questions that they're gonna interview me, he tells me, everybody that comes in here is crazy. Well, I reported him, and that's why I was not selected. And I would tell the teachers, because my background is medical, if my children were sick, they'd have to be sick enough to go to the doctor. And I would write all their excuses in medical terms, make the teachers work for it. Thank you. Oh, thank you. Since I'm 58% Native American, I gave myself my own name. I call myself Fearless Feather. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. That's very awesome that your young man is into mariachi. My grandkids from my older son, that's a principal where I work at, they were in mariachi and they're awesome. It was awesome. I cried when I saw them in their outfit, because Crystal City, after time passed, there was no mariachi music, nothing. And here they come from Uvalde, and they have the background in mariachi. And it is awesome to work where my son works. I'm a teacher, he's a principal. I see my grandkids come up and get educated too. I have two sons, very proud. My oldest one is a principal, it's got his superintendent certificate. And I have a younger son that was an awesome carpenter, built awesome things, but took the wrong road, and he's in prison right now. That is my next goal, of trying to make some changes in that prison system. It is horrible, horrible, what's happening to them inside. You hear, my son is an activist there at the prison where he's at for others. He tells me, Mom, please send so-and-so. He doesn't have any shoes and he needs this. Or he helped a group of older amputees there that nobody took a heart for them. The COVID patients, it's a long thing, so that he continues to help people while he's there. But we need to get together. All these kids, the 800 and some, was it 80,000 or Velma, how many students are we've dropped out? That IDRA, the number 800 and... $82,000 dropouts in.
Question.
And what I'm saying is we're losing all these kids. What's happening to them? We need to find a way to bring them back. This private growth of prisons out there, a lot of these people, the Mexican-Americans, our young Black men too, going in for very little things, are going into prison and being left there. Any little thing, the time extends. Will these private prisons have to keep the profits, have to keep this men enslaved there? A lot of our young men, we need to change the prison system. And it's not just because my son's there, it's because I see the heartache of so many and the numbers that are out there. So, anybody had a question?
Yeah, we actually have a young.
Yes, hi, my name is Nayeli Aleman. I'm a senior in SAISD. And I do know that my great-grandfather, Reynaldo Sobrevia, won under La Raza Unida Party in Cotulla, Texas. But my question was about the impact that La Raza Unida had on local politics besides Crystal City in South Texas.
Yeah, you were talking about your great-grandfather, your grandfather?
Great-grandfather.
Great-grandfather was involved in La Raza Unida Party, but the question is about the success of La Raza Unida Party in addition to Crystal City.
I'm sorry, still... At the local level, sorry.
The success of La Raza Unida Party at the local level in other than Crystal City.
Where was it?
Yeah, where were those successes?
Raza Unida was here in Bexar County. It was active in Austin. It was active throughout the state of Texas. But initially, Raza Unida won in Crystal City, in Carrizo Springs, a couple of the smaller Uvalde. But there was a Raza Unida party throughout the state of Texas. Even up in North Texas, there was a Alma Canales who ran for office for the lieutenant governor position, and probably was the first time a woman had run for that position. Texas has had a woman governor twice, but that was the first time that we know of that a woman had run. So basically the partido was all over the place, and that came from a decision actually, because we started small and we're winning in the rural areas, and Angel, I think, had wanted to stay in the rural areas and try to make some victories there and build. Mario and many of us wanted to look at the statewide thing, which meant, like I said, we had to abide by certain rules. But, you know, some people argue, well, maybe if you had gone incremental, you might have gone further. I don't know. I think that a number of things, when you ask the question, what brought the partido to an end? There's a number of things that did. You probably know that in some cases, some of the leadership went to prison. There was some infighting that happened. But also, what people don't realize was that the Democratic Party and the Republican Party, but particularly the Democratic Party, were really working against the Raza Unida, because they'd seen what had happened in Cristal. There was a real fear. There was a fear that we were taking votes away. Remember that Mexicanos or Chicanos, Mexican-Americans, were always considered loyal to the Democratic Party. And so there was that fear that we were taking these folks away. Consequently, we had the intimidation by the Rangers at the different polls, and a lot of other types of issues that would arise. So you knew that if you messed up even a little bit, it would not only bring harm on you, but on the entire party. At that time, I can remember that a Black man in Houston, for having two joints, went to prison for 20 years, two joints. So it was very easy to imprison people. It's very easy to knock out some of that leadership and to intimidate people.
Also very quickly, as a result of La Raza Unida and our uprising there and asking for our rights and being successful, we have really been cut from a lot of businesses that left the area and did not come back. We have very little businesses in there. They don't want to go to Crystal City, no matter. Once this man came from to start a company, and when he came in and sat before us in city council, he said, I was expecting you all out there with guns. And he was a white person. And he said, we thought you all had guns. And no, we don't. I said, we have been punished, okay? Crystal City has been punished for rising up. And even we don't have the same amount of money. This is happening with the oil and the gas. If you look at Carrizo Springs and you look at La Pryor, where I work at, the amount of money they're getting is tremendous. They have a lot of money to do schools, to do a lot of stuff. Yet Crystal City is not even close. They don't dig there. They don't, it's like there's nothing going on. Like, we don't have oil. Like, we don't have a lot. I think that's part of the punishment. They're not going to give us the ability to do that. So you will be punished. You will, it happened to me with jobs too. So when you're very vocal, people, whoever is, and it's even Mexicanos, okay? Now it's not just the white people. It's even Mexicanos that are there. They don't want to hire. I had to get an attorney for me to work in the school district because they wouldn't hire me. They had a young lady that was working as a teacher without even a high school diploma. And here I was applying and with a degree in biology, and they wouldn't give me a job. So I hired an attorney so I could get a job there, okay? So this happens to us. We get, what do you say, blackballed?
And we all went through that.
It's, I mean, all, everybody.
Most of us that were in Bexar County too, I can remember going on job interviews and I'd always make the top three, but I'd never get the job. Yeah. And I made the top three because they were afraid that if they didn't put me in there, I was gonna, you know, God knows what they thought I was going to do. But we did pay a price. But okay. I think the last laugh is on us. We have the last laugh because, you know, I have two sons that have served. One is a mayor, another right now is a congressman. I have four grandchildren that are probably going to do something with their lives. I think that we're in a different place in a lot of different ways, but we're facing some of those same issues. And I think it's always good to remember what people in the past were able to do, and also to come up, based on the resources that you have now, to come up with ideas of what we can do now. Moss is a great example.
Okay. Talking to your reps and advocating for yourselves and your communities. Can you remember what kind of, I mean, I'm working in a space right now where we can, where we're offering programs kind of like that. So I would love to be able to hear what kind of trainings you are doing.
And I'm how having trouble. What is it that you want me to?
What kind of trainings did y'all hold for each other?
Yeah, type of trainings that you did with La Raza Unida Party, right?
Well, I'll say in Crystal City, we went through the Saul Alinsky training in organizing. We went through the whole, us young people that were still in high school, went through that training. Ernie Cortez also came in and brought training on voter registration, how to talk to people. We learned the rules of the ballots and all that. As a matter of fact, he also taught us how to run a meeting. What was the name of that?
See, but here in Bexar County, we did that all ourselves. We had our own people learn it and then teach it to everybody. And that's what was valuable, because you know, and every teacher knows that, and every person knows that if you're teaching something, you're learning it too.
Yes.
And that was who was really
very valuable for us. And besides that, we would do, like I mentioned, the YWCA, we would go and different women that had different specialized talents in an area would then talk about that. Luz Gutierrez would talk about how you write a proposal. She funded, she got a clinic funded in Crystal, which they hadn't had.
Still there.
So all these people that had skills, they would then impart that skills. And I think that that's a really good model for now, you know, is that if you let people do the training, they learn. The other thing is, if you're on any of the progressive sites, they're doing a lot of free training online for helping you to organize. There's also now a lot more candidate training. There wasn't when we were around. Now there is. All the way to the Harvard level, to here, and I'm sure there's different ones, but here, the Hispanic Chamber runs one for people who want to be candidates and all of that stuff. So, I mean, the training is out there.
But also, like you say, learning, but we had a mentor, and that was Jose Angel Gutierrez and his wife. And I believe that's wonderful if each one of you becomes a mentor to somebody younger, because that's what they did. They gave up a lot of their life and time for us students, not just me, just a lot of other students. For example, before we even got anywhere and we started attending meetings, they taught us the Robert Rules of Orders. He says, this is your new Bible. This is what's gonna get you through and stop things from going through. And we learned it. I mean, we learned that when I was on the city council, I used that so that I could get things off of the table.
Yeah, that's one of the things I used to teach was parliamentary rules.
Yes, so you have mentors out there. I'm very grateful to Jose Angel Gutierrez, because he taught us a lot. He gave a lot of himself. He had faith in us that we were gonna get educated. My dad always said, you all are going to college, but I didn't even dream. I said, I don't want my dad working. He worked very hard. How was he gonna send, there were six of us, sent us to college. But when Jose Angel came in, he showed us how to do the paperwork for the Pell Grant and for
FAFSA.
Financial aid, a scholarship. He gave us hope that we didn't have. And then we, for example, all in my family, we all got educated. I have nurses, mechanics. My brother teases me because he says I have a master and he makes much more with a 2-year degree as a mechanic with his business. So RNs, a doctor, we all went to school. A police officer, but he worked 2 weeks and he said, that's not for me.
give you a little bit of information. Tonight's event is the second of three that we have planned for the month, honoring the work and history of La Raza Unida, its leaders that we see up on the stage. And the next event is October 30th at 4 p.m., a few blocks down on West Commerce at 15 West Commerce at Jaime's Place. And that is a fundraiser for Academia America. We are a nonprofit organization that serves immigrants in San Antonio. So one of the ways that we operate is by having fundraising events. And this is an event you're invited. We're selling a plate, and we will honor four persons, four leaders in the Raza Unida Party. You see on stage Severita Lara, and we have Irma Mireles from San Antonio, and then from Austin, we have Maria Elena Martinez, who served as state chair for the party in 1976 to 78, and then we have Alma Canales from Waco, Texas, who was Raza Unida's candidate for lieutenant governor in 1972. We will honor those four women as part of our series. And we have one more event, but that is by the city of San Antonio. On October 28th, at the meeting of the city council, the city of San Antonio will issue a proclamation honoring the work of Raza Unida. So you're invited. You're invited to attend that city council session on October 28th. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
If you want to buy tickets for the for fundraiser, you can get those at our website, www.academiaamerica.org. That's www.academiaamerica.org.
Okay. So I think this probably, we can bring our discussion to an end. So I want to thank very much our speakers, Rosy Castro, Severita Lara. I think you presented a really complex and large picture of what La Raza Unida Party, a lot of the struggles that were going on in the 60s and 70s. I appreciate very much, and I think it's very important to bring those to our contemporary times, because we are living times that are very difficult, and we see this rise of white supremacy, very serious attacks on democracy. So we know that we need to continue to organize, to honor all the work that has been done, but know that there is a lot of work that we have to continue to do. So please, let's thank you.
I would just like to thank all of you that are here so late in the day, and for you coming in. And I would also like to thank all of those that came before us. I'm one little drop in that Raza Unida bucket. There was many people, our elderly, some that are already gone, that worked very hard for the Raza Unida and the Chicano, the causa de nosotros. I consider myself a Chicana. I still do. That's the name we gave ourselves. And I'm still an advocate. And La Raza Unida is not gone. It's right here. And we exhibit it every time we help somebody else. We give a hand. We try. We're helping that other person. And that's La Raza Unida. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.